Hello everyone, my name is Benjamin Arnaud, aka Bungie. I'm very good today, thank you very much, and today we're coding MotionBox the Video Browser live once again.
Hello.
So let me pause the stream behind here. Okay, so like I said in the previous stream, we're going to code to implement torrent parsing on MotionBox. So I've been busy the last few days and I didn't have the time to clean the code that we did last time, which is, if you remember well, successfully parsing and viewing a few information inside of a bencode file. So what we're going to do right now is just start right away, clean the code and move on with the torrent parsing. So let's get running. Let's go. So once again, don't hesitate to ask questions in the chats. And if I notice something blinking on my right, which is on my right screen, I'll probably make a small break and try to answer things. You know, once again, this is I'm very new in the streaming department here, so I'm learning the ropes and I'm trying to get better as we go. So bear with me and let's try to do something cool. So let's review what we did last time. If I remember well, what we had was pretty much a working parser. Let me condense that a little bit. And we successfully viewed the content of a torrent, which was the Big Bug Bunny torrent. So as a reference here, let me open the Wikipedia torrent file page, so that we can review a bunch of things there. So here's the file structure of a torrent bncode file, if you will. First of all, there's the annonce, which is the URL of the tracker, which is most likely useful to retrieve the information and the data of the file. Then there is the information dictionary, which contains a bunch of things, actually. The name, which is a suggested file name, so it's not that important. What's really important, though, is the path here, which is the list of strings corresponding to subdirectory names. Actually, the files themselves. What we're really interested in is extracting the torrent to see what's inside, so we can then display, like I said, all the tracks, whether they're MP4 or anything else, AVI, like in this case, and then let the user play it right away. So if I drag and drop the torrent file here on MotionBox, nothing happens visually for now, but in the console we can see that there's a bunch of things. I noticed by looking at the replay from the last time that the integer is not properly passed here, so we need to fix that. It's zero all the time, and I'm not sure that's the proper value here. So maybe it's an issue, there's an issue there. But as you can see, we got the tracker. So if we get back here, the tracker is there. We got the creation date, which is null, so it's not normal. And we got info just like here. Let me put this on the side. Yep. Okay. So info, and inside of it, a dictionary with 5 files. A bunch of things, actually. An AVI, a TXT, and a PDF. No, sorry, 5 is the length of the files, but there is actually 3 of them. And for every time there's a file, it's actually, yeah, a list or a dictionary. Okay, so what we're interested really in that is just extracting that. We need to extract that file and display it right there so that the user can actually play it. So let's answer a few questions and then I'll clean the code and we'll commit it as it is. I was supposed to commit it before this time, but busy week. So let's do it live. Why not? Let's be authentic. Let's be real. So are you testing? So there's a question. Are you testing or plan on testing? Well, I would like to do it, and I would like to do a few unit testing and automated tests. For now, I haven't. I have actually tools to make functional interaction with the application. For instance, the trailer that you're seeing on Motionbox is... let me randomize the playback here. For instance, the video you see on the Motionbox website was entirely rendered with APIs that are actually zooming in and out and scrolling on the application. So I can do both unit testing and functional testing. But the more important question is, wouldn't that be cool if people could actually test it on their side? So I'm actually waiting a little bit to have contributors. And in the next days, what I would like to do is a to-do file or a task file to suggest eventual contributor what they could help with. For instance, there's testing, there's translation, there's porting to another platform like Linux. There's a lot of things that could be done very easily since the code is very clean and that could be contributed to. Because the project is getting very big for me, very huge. And since I'm streaming now because I want to show my development process, I realize that I'm going to need help in building it really soon. So I plan on testing myself, but that would be even better if a few contributors could do it. So I don't know, maybe I need to contact a few people there. We'll see. But anyway, let's go back to the parsing here with the beautiful Warcraft OST in the back. I hope it's not too loud for you, don't hesitate to tell me. And let's minimize that. Well, actually, you know what, let's quit it. So let's figure out why we get a zero here when extracting the integer. So once again, let's display that. So today I really hope to complete this, which is just extracting the file name so that we can display the track, and then we'll let libtorrent do its stuff, because libtorrent really what it needs is a point torrent as a parameter. I'm not going to support magnet right away because magnet are a little bit of a tedious approach with what I'm doing, because magnet, you don't get the file list before starting to download them. And that's something I don't want to do, because if I start to download every time I'm passing a magnet, it's going most likely to be a little bit of an overkill for the user's bandwidth. So I want to avoid that. So unfortunately, Motionbox will most likely support torrent in the first iteration. Maybe magnet too, but for the default, the very first video file in the magnet, not for the list of files you could find inside a torrent. Okay, so let's try that again. Let's go straight to the... Okay, so... integer string there. Okay, so as we can see, it's a very long string. So we have an issue there. Backend bend code N. From. Okay. So, okay, let me look again at that. Yeah. So. Yeah. The end parameter is the end indexed is here. So yeah, once again, this is a mistake from that. Okay. I need to revise my mid behavior here, my mid. It's kind of the same issue we had there last time. I forgot that it's not that, you know, it's not two indexes that you provide here, but really a length. And actually, I don't think that's that convenient. Maybe there's a way called something like mid, except here it's another index and not count. So now we should have something proper to display. Let's see. So, nope. You never learn, do you? Okay. Like this. Okay. Now we got integer. I don't really care about them anyway, because that's just the length. I guess I don't really care about it. What I care about is the file name. Let me test something for a sec here. What if I do that? Whoops. I like the very subtle txt file here. Promote your content on Frostwire. You know, very subtle. So here, let me check something. I'll explain in a sec why I'm doing this. Maybe you could guess. I'm actually doing this because one of the things that I plan on doing is automatically retrieving a picture of the current torrent I'm parsing on. So I need to find out a way to pretty much clear the file name to find a proper Google query or anything else to retrieve that kind of picture. For instance, when you are accessing the Big Bug Bunny torrent here, MotionBox will be able, and that's one of the strengths of MotionBox. MotionBox is not just a video player. MotionBox is also a very strong image processor, image displayer, if you want. You can really go very fast, as you can see, skim through them. And that took a long time to code. Because believe it or not, dealing with that big of an amount of images and loading them very fast, so you can just browse through them extremely fast, and some of them are really big files, are really big picture files actually. It was a little bit hard to do. So one of the value of MotionBox is not just accessing the video file right away, it's also giving you an idea of what's inside. And the problem with torrent, and maybe you'll have a suggestion for that, is that by default they have no cover. There might be a cover inside of the torrent, but like I said before, I don't want to start parsing the torrent before playing it. I don't want to start playing, pretty much loading the torrent, because it's going to, start downloading and uploading and everything. I don't want to do that for now, at the very least. I would like to find a way from the video file to determine what's the proper cover to display. So whether I'm loading it, whether I'm finding it on Google Images, or I don't know, maybe on some other sites that can provide covers, the only issue I have is that since MotionBox is a generic player, as opposed to what Popcorn Time would be, for instance, I cannot rely on IMDb, because I'm not just going to load movies, and we're talking of legal ones, obviously. I'm going to load every single torrent that has an AVI file inside of it. So if there is no relevant return, I need to figure that out, because I don't want to display some random and unrelevant picture. Also, what I would like to do is display a photo and maybe let the user decide if he wants it or another one. So that you get an image right away, but if that's not the proper one, you can switch to the second one, which might be the good one. But at least it gives you something graphical. Because that's what's cool about MotionBox, is seeing your content and playing it right away. Seeing and playing. That's what is interesting about it. But anyway, let's clear the cache here and let's continue. So now that everything is passed here, what I'm going to do is a bit of a cleaning. We'll commit that and then we'll transition to the extracting, which is the important part for MotionBox. And then we'll be pretty much done with this first iteration of the Bencode parser, so we can switch to start implementing LibTorrent, but not today, most likely. We'll see. So let's review everything here. So here are the different types inside of a BN code file. So integer, string, list, dictionary, you know, and the end character, which is, you know, just the end character. It's not the same type as those, as these. So let's put it there. So here we have the extract value generic function that we created, the integer, string, list, dictionary is there. We've extracted value by giving data and then accessing the current character. Actually, I wonder if I've used that before. Yeah. So as you can see here, instead of using current char, I'm using character, which makes it cleaner from my perspective. That's one of the important things that I do. I clean the code every time. I review it, I clean it. I want it to be written just right. You know, it's not just about how it works. It's about how it looks, how it reads. Because think about it, you're not going to spend time only running that code. You're going to improve on it. You're going to make it better. And if it's difficult to read, you know, you're not really going to care, and you will want to avoid the ugly part of it. So you have to make sure that it's readable, that people are understanding it, and making it work great too. So something is wrong here. I guess we can return that as is with the data length. Actually, we could return. Yeah. If something is wrong, we're going to, why not? So if something is wrong, we're going right at the end, right away, because something shouldn't be wrong, right? And we want to avoid to parse every single character. Going to make it more readable here. Yeah. Wait a sec. Well. No. Index plus number, yep, get at the end of the string, sounds good, then display the string with the length. Well, who cares, let's just display the string here, don't care about the length of it, it's going to be confusing. So there's a question there. Chicken skill. For the image preview, I did not dig into it, but what about Wolfram language? Okay, so I don't know what that is, so we'll take a look real quick. That's interesting. I thought about linked data, if you've ever heard about that, which is pretty much the standard brought up by Tim Berners-Lee, you know, the inventor of the web, as he is being referred to sometimes. And linked data is interesting because you can pretty much, you know, associate a data with a cover, most likely. But that's not the case at the moment. Unfortunately, the state of the art. And Motionbox is not developed as, you know, a software is supposed to define a standard, because it would take years to adopt. If I try to define a standard, you know, until the standard becomes really standard, it will take a long time. So I'm trying to do MotionBox for the world as it is today. And maybe there will be a few de facto standards that come away from it. But right now, you know, I'm just parsing things as they are. And currently, when you're parsing a torrent, unfortunately, like I said, you know, you don't get much visual about it. You just get a torrent. And if you have a good idea on how we could solve that, but for anything, for any file, you know, Wolfram might be interesting, but you know, what I thought about was just pretty much accessing Google Image and parsing the title and try to find something relevant here. And checking, maybe there's a way to do that with Google, but checking if it's relevant or not. Because if it's not relevant at all, we don't want to display, I don't know, a picture that has nothing to do with the content. Because if we display something that fits the content, it feels great, right? You're parsing the content, you get the proper picture, awesome. I mean, it's great. But if we display something that is completely off, it's even worse than not displaying anything at all, which is kind of the issue. You know, if you're displaying something that is, well, if you're accessing something well-known, the picture might be fitting, so you'll be happy. But if it's something pretty unknown, we don't want to display something completely off, which is the difficult part here. But let's resume the coding. So the list from data, yep, and data, yep. So here I'm checking from data length before doing an add, because the add function doesn't check if the index is valid or not. So if we do an add at the end, it might crash. Then backend and the year is there. This is more visual, this way, you know, just let it this way, from, yeah. Oops. We need plus one here because we're on back end. And so yeah, okay, and dictionary. String, list, dictionary. Okay. Yep. So that should be the same line here. It's pretty much the same function, actually. So yeah, just going to we're going to rename extract by view for the sake of this because view is, whoops, no, not that. Tag value here, okay, yeah, it should stay this way, extract playlist. So yeah, I can think of a consistent and simple solution, someone says in the chat. Chicken skill, obviously. Well, if something comes up, don't hesitate to let me know. I'm thinking about that. I've been thinking about that for a few days now, and we'll see when comes the time to implement it, how it feels, because even if we find that something that's in theory a good solution. When you implement stuff, you get surprises. So, you know, we just need to do the thing and we'll see how it feels. So I'll resume coding, because one of the things that I noticed is that when you're streaming, you have a hard time focusing. So I need to figure that out. To avoid confusion, you've got to compare metadata. Yeah, but I'm not sure what kind of metadata I might compare against what. If I'm using Google Image, for instance, I'm not sure how to know if the current result I'm getting on Google is a good fit or not. Now, then again, maybe if you display a completely off image for a given torrent, you can give an option on the GUI to say, hey, that's not the proper image, define another one or modify the keyword so that we can find it for you. The great stuff, once again, is having your video visually, because if you type Big Bug Bunny and you get the picture of the bunny before playing it, I mean, man, this looks cool. So we need to make that happen. And that's one of the things that's really great when you're thinking about software like Popcorn Time, is when you run the program, it's like a Netflix. You see all those movie cover, all those movie posters, and so it's very visual. And that's what makes it interesting, and I think attractive to people too. Useful. But of course, it's mostly illegal, so don't use it at home, kids. But anyway, let's resume that. So view value, yeah, ABN code, we don't need to do that. So I've assumed that the ABN code file for torrent are UTF-8, which is probably the case. Maybe it's just, yeah, we'll leave it that way for now. But so while we're at the end of the file, we'll just view value. Not sure if I'm doing things right here. Let's try it again. As you can see here, I could add the torrent as a playlist, which is convenient if you want to add it right away. But let's browse it instead. Oh, something is messed up here. Pieces, yeah. It's the pieces of the inside of the file. And there's a bunch of things here. Yeah. The path. Okay. Well. Okay, I guess we can commit that. Do they ever do function with that kind of stuff? I don't really like the naming though. Yeah. You know what? Let's keep it this way. Longer, and it's not exactly what we are doing, but I like it better that way. Okay. Okay. Cool. So, that was the last episode, but today is episode 3. Who knows how it will be called. And today, we'll do 76. And okay. So, let's commit. I hate when this happens. Okay. Maybe there's a way to disable that in Windows. You know what? Okay, never mind. Was not found for an MD file. Well, you know what? Forget it. It's okay. So let's diff everything. So let's review it real quick. So we've added control application, backend bencode integer there. Lit string, list, dictionary, the end. Okay, function extract value, extract integer, string, list, dictionary. Okay, extract value. So every time I commit something, I reread the code. Normally I do that the next morning, but we'll do it real quick to avoid mistake here. Character, backend, bincode, integer, on extract integer, bincode list, list. Yeah, so integer, data from, list from plus one. Yeah, dictionary, character, plus one. List number, data from, not plus one. So obviously we need the number itself, and then return data length if it's if there's an issue. Now extract integer. Is this playing randomly? Yeah. Because we already heard that one. Okay. Okay, extract integer, backend bencode hen. Yep. Okay. From plus one, data mid, from index minus from to int. Integer number index plus one. Yeah, because we're on the end character there. Are we sure of that? Integer end. That's the cool thing about it, which is normally, since I've added every single link you need, I can check that real quick. And yeah, when it's an integer, there's an end character at the end. Which is obvious, because otherwise you wouldn't know the length of the int. So extract integer there. That's one. Yeah. Number. Yep. Cool. Number, yep. Index plus one because we want the end character. Extracting data from. Backend bencode string from. Yep. Okay, the end index once again. If it's invalid, then we get away. Not sure why I do that though. Yeah. Yeah, okay, never mind. It's good enough. Index from, index plus plus. Why am I doing index plus plus? Yeah, because so hold on. Index plus plus means that we are after it. Yeah. Index plus number means that we're at the end. Okay. Okay. Extract list. Okay. Data from list. Dictionary. Yep. Data from the extract value. Data from plus one. Yep. Okay. And then here we got get URL place that we wrote last time with info.id, which is something normal, I guess. I guess I could streamline that so you don't have to rewrite it for every backend. We'll see that later. Get query playlist here. Okay. Track place data. Index 0. Cool. keep it clean. Already been cut there, so can keep it clean like that. Clean. Add. Okay, so so now we have to figure out, so now we've extracted and displayed the torrent file, so it works on one of these, but we have to try others because, you know, it's good to support one, but what about if I'm using another one? Big Bug Bunny. So there's another one here. Okay. Can't figure out what's in there. Okay. Cool. Okay. Okay. So here, as you can see, there's a comment. And that might be useful in matching pictures because here it's very clear what that is. You know, but comment could be completely unrelated to the file, so I'm not sure if it's a relevant way for doing that. But anyway, here we can see that we have BBB. So the file we're looking at is there. So then again, if I'm doing this, and I'm doing that, yeah, as you can see, it's not going to display relevant stuff, which is a shame because I really want the proper cover. So in that case, you know, that it should be completely off, which is annoying. Oh! See? By just removing the underscore and the point here, we get something which is kind of relevant, though. So yeah, that's a shot of the Big Bug Bunny, actually. It's not very cool, but maybe if we do something like search tools, size, large, yeah, medium, and then we get this one. So as you can see, by tweaking a little bit with the parameter, just removing the underscore and maybe removing the point MP4 here, because who cares about that? Then we get a bunch of results. Yeah. Maybe I could also try to parse and remove those things. I don't need that. And then again, I get even better results. So you get the idea of how we could parse and extract. Maybe there's a large. Yeah, even better. Once again, we stumble upon a large photo. So imagine accessing that very obscure torrent, you know, which is named like this, and being able to retrieve a picture like that. I mean, it's really cool. And you don't need any server in the middle to achieve that. It should work. It could work with just a simple algorithm, which is pretty much removing the underscore, stripping away the resolution there and the frame per second. And yeah, just accessing a large image on Google. But once again, this could be completely off. You know, if we like, if we get this, I mean, if we get the Beach Boy covers, you know, it's not what we want to display. And so that's the issue I have with that mechanism, though. I'm not sure if it's reliable. But anyway, so what we need to extract there, what we're really interested in, is just this name. So if I look at the structure again here, with a bunch of things. So info. So I need to go straight to info. There. I need to go straight to info. And no, I need to go straight to files. Or even better, I need to go straight to path. Where is this? Info, dictionary, file media. Oh, he's calling it file media and not files. That's annoying. Why is it a file media here? Info, I'm okay with that, but file media, that's not standard, should be called files. Hold on. Is this not standard? So here, we get files. Okay. Okay. So here we get this structure. Okay. Let's take a look in that. So in this torrent file, we get this. Okay. So that's the first one. In the second one though, the other one. Oh, sorry about that. We get this. File media and file duration. Let's display it. And so I'm not sure what the hell is going on here because it's not the proper naming there. So we got the info all right, it's there. But then again, it's file duration and file media. And the path here is called name there. Whoa. Let's take a look. So the comment is there, pieces are there, file duration, creation date. Yep, okay. There, file media. With a list. And it starts with an integer of 0. Why would you want to do that? Integer 0, and again, and then length. Hold on. 6 length. Okay. Do I parse length all right? Yeah, length here. So length would be that. Yeah, thanks in there. Okay. Okay. Trying to figure out how we're going to parse that. I have an idea. I think what we can do is extract all the path or extract all the names and then look if it's an MP4 or an AVI or anything video-like. And if that's the case, just return it. So, the thing that I don't understand is the fact that here, maybe something is wrong, but let me check. Here, there's a name right away. Like, what the hell? The name is right away, and then Ori, and then the name. So it's not inside the list. Or I'm doing a mistake here. So list, what's zero here? Okay, list integer zero, okay. And, so the end of the integer, the end of the list. Something is really wrong with that list. Why is there two E here? Yeah, because that's the end of the list, but that's not the end of the dictionary, okay. So we're still inside of a dictionary. String dictionary, okay. So here we're going in a list. You know what? Let's do something. Yeah, as you can see, it's just a weird list here. But still, we're inside the dictionary. So here we have a value, a key, sorry, matches with the list. Here is another value, found media, that matches with the list. Here another value that matches with an integer, and here another value that matches with this. So since there's just one file inside of that, then it's just like name and BB flower. And since it's a dictionary, then the key is there and the value is there. So yeah, my parser is okay. Yeah, okay. So we need to parse. This. Plus the next string, which in that case would be that. So we need to make sure it's the next string, because here there's a list and we need to look under that. We need to just parse the next list. So how am I going to know that it's a list? Well, I just have to browse values until I'm on a list, I'm on a string. And when I'm on a string, just extract that and boom, I have it. Here, I just need to extract name plus the next string. And here in that case, that would be there. And that's all we need. And then we have a track. By just having the name file, the file name, sorry, and the torrent file, we then can call libtorrent, and we can tell it, okay, load this torrent, but only load that file, only extract this file in the torrent. And it should work well. So if there's just one file, obviously it won't make a difference, but if there is a lot, you know, a video player does not need to load the TXT or anything else related. We just need the file, the video file. Okay, so now that we've said that, we're going to implement it. Let's do it. So, let's go. Here I get the content, what I want to access. I want to extract every file. So to extract any file, I need to do something like We need to extract path or name. Let me see if I can do it simply. Yeah. So we're probably going to need a regex to do it. But for now, I'm just going to test with path, which is this one. I'm going to download it. Yep, this one. Oh, by the way, so yeah, he has a name. I don't want this one. I want this one. No, I want this one here. What the? Huh. Okay, hold on. There's a path, but there's also a name. Name. Suggested file name. Okay, no, I don't want that. I want the path. Can I switch the view here? Why? Okay, so hold on a sec. Why? Is there no path? Not very cool, dude. So here, there's no path. There's just the name. But if we look at the documentation here, it's just a suggested file name. So this is not standard here. There should be a path somewhere. For some reason, there is no path, which is annoying. And so here, we open that. Here we got a name from the first occurrence, which is not a file at all, which is just not a file at all, but we got path. So I'm going to have to extract both. I think what I can do is I can start by extracting the path, every single path, pretty much. And if nothing's found, I guess I can fall back on the name here. I can fall back on the name. So we're going to extract both anyway. Okay, cool. I'm not sure why it doesn't stay on top here. Okay. So before I do so, maybe there's question. Don't hesitate to ask them if you have a few. So now, first of all, we need to extract the name. So here it's getting pretty obvious that I need to add a new function. So these are the previous function we just did for the sake of displaying values. But now I'm going to do extract name. So with the data and from So let's extract the name. So you might be hearing my daughter on the back who is crying, so don't worry. Everything's okay. I'm not like a serial killer imprisoning babies. My wife is behind me, actually. So let's extract the name. Like I said, we got a from here, which is convenient. We're going to do like this. Maybe I can just call it with from. And we need to extract the next forename. We need an index from data, actually. We'll see about that index later. Okay. So yeah. Okay. So next up, we need to extract the string. The data plus 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Whoop. If from doesn't exist, then well, fortunately there's no name. So return that. Yes, I could do that. Maybe this. So here what I'm doing is I'm pretty much passing an index. So that we can start parsing the next value after the current one we're loading. But I'm not sure it's actually useful in that case. Yeah, that's not useful in that case. Why? Because we don't need to start parsing after the name for next values, because with the bencode format, this could be in any order. So we need to make sure that we process them. I'm just going to stick with that for now. Whoops. Okay. Oh, yeah. So here, obviously, I'm not returning -1, I'm returning empty string. Like that. Nope. Like that. No, we don't need that. Well, okay. So we need to extract the string there. And return the string, obviously. But So here I'm really extracting the values this time, not just displaying them. But we need to extract the string. But here, what we need to do is not extract string. What we need to do is extract next string. Although, yeah, now, if it's a name there, then it should be the string right away. But we need to create another function for the path, which is extract next string, because like I mentioned, when it comes to the name here, the following value has to be a string. But if it's the path, the next value is a list, and we don't want to extract that. We want to extract the next string. Okay, so let's do it. Okay, name, that's the str, so let's display the name to see if we properly parse it. That should be good though. Let's see. Whoops. Okay, let's make sure that we're parsing the name properly. Cool, got it. Now we have the name, which is cool, but we need to parse the path. So I guess what I need now is something like that. Now we need to extract the path. And display them. Then yep. Oh. Welcome back, dude. Okay. Yeah, it hasn't. It's normal. So here, like I said, we're now extracting two values. First of all, we need the name, because in some cases, for some reason, there's no path. And so the name is also the file name. So we need to extract that as a, you know, if we don't get any path, we'll just extract the name, and so it will be our file. But now I'm coding the extracting path function, which should return a string list of path. Yeah. Like that. Let me just test one more thing. Whoops. Okay. First of all, I wonder if this works with local file. Yeah. Ah, hold on. One of the thing which is, yeah, it's obviously important to have the name before because with the name I can actually return the playlist name. I can at least name my playlist. So let's do it right now to show you how this works. If I go to my backend YouTube here, for instance, which is a tad more complex than the one we're currently working on, I have an extract playlist here, of course. And here you can see the reply title. So in the reply, you can specify a title, which is what we're going to do. The reply title should be the name, and that should be the title of the playlist. So now, if I'm not mistaken, if I do this, and then I try to parse my local hard drive, you can see that here now the name is actually the name of the name displayed there is actually the name of the torrent. And if I go there, something's not right actually. Should be frost click. Okay, that's weird. But anyway, I think that's a good way to do it. Now, if I parse from an online file directly, let's see what happens. Yeah, now as you can see, it names the playlist. Big Bug Bunny, blah, blah, blah. And previously, it was named differently. It was named by the name of the torrent. So, hold on. What happens if I do that, though? Yeah, not that, but that. Yeah, now it's a frost click playlist, which is not what I want. So yeah, it's progress here. So the name is obviously going to be the name of the playlist, because hey, why not? So that's cool. That's cool. Now we need to extract the path. So thank you, YouTube. Let's go back to our parsing. Here. So before we can extract the path, we most likely need to find the next one. So, yeah. We need to do something like that. Whoops. And we need to do something like that while we're not at the end of all things. Yeah, we just try to parse the path. So here we need to do that. Extracting the next string, which is most likely the file name inside of the path. Like I mentioned, you know, this it could be inside of a list that contains, you know, information like length and anything that we don't need. What we need is this. So let's extract next string here by doing this and by passing the index. Most likely the index like this, because we want to keep the position for the next parsing. Because this time the position matters. So yeah. Did I ever did that? No. Now I'm extracting, I'm creating the function extract next string. Here we can remove that debug. It works well. Okay, so extracting the next string, to do that, we're going to have to do, So like I said, here it's a pointer because I need to keep track. I need to keep track of the position when I'm out of the function. So now we need to find the next string, and there is no easy way to do that because we need to skip actually every single value that is not a playlist. So how to do that? Well. I think we actually need to parse everything. Hold on. I'm going to do a function here, another one. Is the next string index from a given position. So this is the old function that we're not going to need anymore. I'll probably delete them before the next commit. So we need a function here, another one, which is just going to retrieve an index, get string index. That's cool. So now, That's more like it. Did the guest get next, next index? So, while whoops. Yeah, that track is pretty cool. Alright. So, while we're not at the end of the document and data at from that's a bit of a weird convention here is not a string. How would we know that? Yeah, needs to be a number. It needs to be a number. Okay, let's do that. Cleaner, even if it does here at, but it's clean. So yeah, while we're not on a string, we're going to get next index. I'll stick with from. It's better. As you can see, I'm changing my mind lots of time. But yeah, should be good this way. Here. Okay, so here we're getting an index. So. Okay. No, we don't want to do that. We want to do that. If from equals minus one. Then get the hell out of here. In here, what we want to do is the same thing, most likely. Okay, so here, we know that we're on a string, so we're very happy. Here, what we need to do is pretty much return extract string. Data and from. And that's about it. And you know what? Never mind the position here. Yeah. Just do it this way. I'll see about optimization later. One of the tricks when you're coding something for the first time is to not worry about optimizing or making sure that it goes as fast as possible, because if you do that, you're most likely going to screw up the simple implementation. So, make it simple first, and then make it fast. Okay. So, yeah, obviously you're not very happy about that, aren't you? So here what we can do is that. Now, yeah. Probably need to do that too. Yeah, I could do a do while here, but I'm not very keen on the syntax. Let me check here. Yeah. So here I could implement the skip string stuff, but I'm not sure I need it. We're not going to do it. Just going to, you know, if it's get next in index, if it's not an integer, not a list, not a dictionary, then just return from, I don't know, let's do this. Maybe that. So this should get us to the next index, and if the next index is not a number, then let's go to the next one. So hold on. Yeah, if it's not a number. Yeah. You know what? We don't need to do that. We just need to do that. Simple as that. So if from nothing, do that. But yeah, we need to do something like that, most likely. So yeah, if it's not a number, then it's necessarily obviously an integer, at least, or a dictionary. So if that's the case, what we want is to grab the index 10 as long as it exists, and if it doesn't. If it does, okay. I'm gonna do that. Whoops. I'm gonna increase that if that's the case. Nah, do it this way. Okay. So I don't need that anymore, do I? Oh, why am I going here? No, I don't need to do that. Extract next string. Okay, here. Okay. Directly. So the index is obviously going to be plus 6. 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So here, going to be that. The match like this. Is obviously going to be path. Get that. Yeah. So maybe there's a better way of writing that. I have to figure it out. There we go. So now. Yeah, matching the next path here. So here, what we need to do is to actually clear the freaking list. And do that. Oops. My keyboard is not facing me. So when your keyboard is not facing you, obviously you're typing wrong stuff. So here I'm appending the path. Or am I? Yeah, extract next string. Yeah. Okay, so here I'm doing that. Could do that actually. Let's keep it readable. So let's review the code and let's run it. I'm not testing much. Maybe I should test more. Okay. So like I said, we're extracting the name. So we can name our playlist, or if there is no path, we can deduce that the name is the path. Here we're extracting path. And here we're doing something not good. Yeah, like that. So here we're extracting the path and we're putting all the path inside of a list. That's what we do. And so, whoops. Let's try not to spill my coffee here. Okay. So here, yeah, we're just matching path. And if we have an index, it's valid. You know what? We're just extracting the next string, which is a little bit of an algorithm here. We have to make sure that works. We're obviously starting to extract the next string after the path expression. So that's 6 character there. That's the reason why I added 6. And then we're appending it to the list. And then we're going to the next match. Fairly simple. Simple stuff. So here we're extracting the next string from a position, which is this position. So while we're not on a number, we know that it's not a freaking string. Because like you know, as I mentioned before, as we've seen before, when you're parsing a torrent, a band code, the only exception that does not start with a matching keyword is the string. It starts with a number. So it can get confusing. A number is not an integer, it's a string. Start with a number that says, hey, you're going to parse that amount of characters. In that case, we know that if we don't get out of from that, it means that we are on another expression, integer, list, or dictionary. So by elimination, not sure if it has the proper word in English, but I can deduce that we'll necessarily have to parse the backend band code n, because every single other entity value here are ended by a backend end. So I can avoid doing that and just do straight away the index of backend end to get to the next value. Really simple. And if that backend end is -1, then we're at the end of the file, so we need to return. But it's not. If that's not the case, then let's do a from +++. So that we can move out from the end character and check if it's a number. And if it's a number, cool, now we can extract the string. Pretty simple. So let's do it. Yeah. So we don't need that. We need that. We can do that. Let's try to... Yeah, I don't know. Let's try to... make this more readable. And it compiles, but does it work? Let's find out. Let's find out. Yeah. Infinite playlist, infinite loop here. Another one. It's very easy to get trapped in these. Okay, so Where is the infinite loop? Where might it happen? So while index -1, extract next string. So let's say that the index is different than -1 here. We can extract the next string now. Okay. Yeah, we're extracting the next string. Okay. Oh. Yeah, that's the issue there. I'm parsing the same index and looping on it. So you know what? Let's freaking skip it and do that, so that the next time... Oh, and by the way, I need to do that starting from index. Otherwise, I'm going to parse the same path over and over and over again, which is not what I want. And here, it should be good. So let's see if it's any better. If it crashes any better. All right. Cool. So, it doesn't work, but it doesn't crash. All right, so as you can see here, for some reason, we're not skipping the path, and we're not skipping the name. Wow, what the F? So that's not, shouldn't happen this way. Let's see what happens for real. So extract next string, I'm on that. I'm skipping the path. I know the path is there, but I'm skipping it. And so here, should never retrieve the path. Should retrieve something else. Unless the next string is a path. No, shouldn't happen. But here, we know we're on the next thing. And the next thing should be... I'm not sure which one I'm testing. I'm testing Frostwire. So this one. So the path should lead to a string, and it should be this one. What the f- Let me test that. Best music ever. Ok. Going to get into trouble to do that, but let's try it. Why would he do that? I mean, he's on a freaking string. Why would you do that? Okay. Next string, baby. So this should be working flawlessly. I mean, nah. Not that. I want the from. Show me the very first 20 next character. I bet they're awesome. Yeah. For some reason, I mean, he's on a freaking string here. And he's extracting path. What the fuck? Oh. Extracting backend index of backend bencode string. Yeah. I mean, what the hell? Why wouldn't this work? I'm missing something probably really obvious, you know, as usual. But hey, that's me. So here we're extracting the string on the very same data at the very same position. And here, I'm not mad, what I'm seeing is this. So why would it return path? It should never return path. Okay. Too many arguments. Yeah. Wow. For some reason, he's not parsing this one. Oh. No. Yeah. Empty. Why would it be empty? Oh, hold on. Because it's a list. Okay. Yeah, that's what I missed out. It's a list. It's not a one. I thought it was a one, but it's an L. So here it's a list, and so... Yeah. It's not going to... Yeah, that's not going to cut it. Yeah, so... Doesn't work this way. But it's not going to be as simple after all. So, let me explain. If we're on a freaking list or on a freaking dictionary. And to evaluate that, we actually need this. So, if the character is a number, it's not a number. Yeah. You know what? Why don't we do that? Sounds risky, huh? So, if it's a list or a dictionary, then oops. Okay. Made it crash again, but yeah. So, here's the code I did this time. If it's a number, if it's not a number, then it might be an integer. And if it's an integer, we need to go at the end. At the end of the integer. Now, if it's a list, well, we need to extract the next content, and the next content might be a number, and if that's a number, we're interested in that, so we should check the content of every dictionary and every list without going straight to the end like I did before, and then we can extract the string, which is what we want to do in the first place. So let's try again. And infinite loop. Let's kill it before it makes us freeze. I love infinite loop. So, if it's an integer, and if it's minus one, get away from that, else from plus plus. What's wrong about that? So, It could be an integer, it could be a list. If it's a list, yeah, just plus one. And if it's a number, we break away. Why does not this work? If it's only proper English there. So, yo. Hold on. Yeah. It doesn't work this way, huh? Okay. Let's do that again, but I think it's working. Woohoo! Amazing, I just parsed a freaking file. So, we got the name there. We got the path. We got the freaking screaming promoting text file, which is the most important file in the torrent, guys. We got the press release, cool, and the license. So, really cool, really cool. We got it working there. So, yeah. So now, there's one last thing we need to do. We need to check if the file is a video file. Yeah, sounds important, doesn't it? So, yeah. And we also need to check another thing. Which is that if path is empty, we need to append the name because the name might be a file. So that should solve the issue I normally have with the other torrent. I'm not sure if that's standard though, but that should solve the problem. As you can see here, the name is also the path for some weird reason. Not sure about that, but for some weird reason, this is what happens. So yeah. Feels like it's playing always the same tracks. I actually need to upgrade a little bit my gaming playlist here. If you have any recommendation, don't hesitate, because right now it's a little bit simple. But yeah, so yeah, works for me. So how do we check if the file is valid? Well, there should be a way to do that with a static function there. So if, let's call it, URL is video. Is it? If it's not, we continue. That's the spirit here. Yeah, indie games. There's a lot of great soundtracks when it comes to indie games. For instance, yeah, Fez, Braid, maybe a few others. And I think I might not get copyright strike for these. But man, I was surprised. Even the independent music maker nowadays, you know, they're striking you on YouTube. You know, it's like they're producing their very first piece of music and they don't want to share it anyway. It's a weird world. I'm not even sure that by playing those tracks right there, for instance, I might have a strike on StarCraft 2 there. Because, you know, the soundtrack might be sold, maybe. And so if that's the case, maybe Blizzard is going to to put a freaking advertisement on top of my content. It's like, you know, I'm casting for 3 hours, and during one small minute in the very background of the video, 1 minute of a given track, copyrighted track, gives away the license from me to the other party, which is a shame. Which is a shame because, man, the stream here is in Creative Commons anyway, so people are allowed to use the content and remix it and change it any way they like, even if they want to include it in a paid content. By the way, I'm very open about that. But since I'm listening to music while I'm coding, I mean, in lots of cases, it puts advertisement on top of it. And I hate that, because when people are going to your videos, they are viewing an advertisement, and they feel like, and they think that it's yours, that it's going to get you money. Well, in the case, in reality, it's for the third party that stole your rights away from you. I hate that. I mean, that's a terrible system, if you ask me. But that's just how YouTube works. So here, and that's one of the reasons too, not to digress too much here, but that's one of the reasons too I'm working on MotionBox. One of the things I'm aiming at doing is motion freedom, what I call motion freedom. And to achieve that, what I really think we need to do is to diversify the places where we upload video. Because think about it, if I have my video in YouTube, but also on Vimeo, and maybe later in Torrents or any other site, really, then the platform are going to have to adapt to be competitive again and to propose unique services, because otherwise we're just going to go to another provider. And now, if you're using a video browser, if you're using the YouTube experience now, sure, you're attached to it, the community and everything, but if you don't really care about that, and what you care about is the content, then if the content matters to you, you're just going to use a video browser, and you don't care if you're streaming it from YouTube, Dailymotion, or any roundup site, really. What you care about is the content. And that's what I would like to do. I would like to free the content from the grasp of those platforms. Because nowadays, they're just stealing away your rights from you, ripping you out from your rights to monetize your content. And they believe it's going to last this way. What I really believe is that the content producer, the people doing the great stuff on YouTube, people couldn't live. I mean, YouTube couldn't live without the motion creators, without the people who create video. People who create video can live without YouTube, though. They could go to another site, they could share their videos content differently. But YouTube cannot live without them. And they believe that since they've built this huge silo with every videos in the world, they think that they got the power here, where indeed we could transition from a centralized state with YouTube to another state really fast if we wanted to. So one of the things that I want to enable with MotionBox is distributed content. That means that the content wouldn't be at one place, but at many places. I have nothing against YouTube. I mean, I'm okay with them. I'm okay with what they're doing. I understand their business model. I understand what they want to do. I understand how they want to profit. But I would like to diversify the proposal here, and I would like to diversify the approach when it comes to online videos. So, here, let's see. So now, I should only display the... I read the chat in a second, by the way. I've seen that it's bleeping there. Now, all we get is this. And we don't get the freaking advertising text file and anything else. So, let's read the chat for a sec. So, okay, I'm happy to be in programming. We don't bitch about useless license stuff. We bitch about other useless things, but not license. Yeah, I mean, you know, one of the issue right now when you're a programmer, and I know that well, is that since there is this open source / free software movement, when you create some code, by default, it has no value if you share it with the world, because it's abundant and everybody can get it. But it has value, really. The time you're spending coding has value, so it should be paid in some ways. But that being said, I think that sharing it is more important. So my philosophy here is, if you can share something abundant and the code is abundant, by the way, so is video files or music files. They're abundant too. That's a reality there. If something is abundant, you have to share it. And then society has to evolve in a way that they can pay people, that they can compensate people for their value, for the value they're creating, without preventing sharing from happening. So my mindset on this is the internet brought us abundance when it comes to file sharing. We should spread the love as much as we can. Sharing should be legal. Now, obviously, we should find a way, and that's on the political side of things, or maybe through bitcoins or other stuff. We should find a way to compensate people that are creating stuff. But afterward, I give you my content first, and if you love what I do, you can help me. That's why I set up a donation page, a Patreon for now, but maybe a donation page later, is because I want to give away everything that I do because I want to share it with you. But at one point, if you can help me and share something with me, I'm happy with that too. But I'm not going to prevent my content to be shared, since it can be shared, just because I want to profit on it. I think this is wrong. So this happened with NPM. Oh yeah, the Node Package Manager. There was a guy that published under the name, and the company with the same name took his right on the name. So he unpublished all his module. Seriously? And one module was hugely used, and so all the modules were kaput, and all of these modules. I think I could talk about NPM and Node another time maybe, but what I think of these. And in lots of ways, lots of people are saying that JavaScript and Node.js is the future of programming. And you know, I've talked to a bunch of guys in the web that wanna pursue, that wanna do great stuff with it. But I have a few issues with the Node technology indeed. I'm using it myself pretty much to generate a bunch of files. But you know, when it comes to JavaScript, for instance, and Node specifically, I mean, look at it. They have so much dependencies that when they're updating their stuff, pretty much in every cases, when you have a bunch of dependency, you're going to have some things that breaks, right? So you're going to need to do maintenance on what you're doing to fix it every time you upload your dependencies, because things are just breaking all the time. And JavaScript is not a very good language at debugging. It's not very safe when it comes to implementation conventions. So it's getting better, it's getting there. Now think about that too. JavaScript is just a scripting language originally, so it needs lower-based C++ code to run well. Now, even though V8 and the basis of Node is very fast and it supports multi-process and stuff like that, I mean, it's just JavaScript at the end of the day. And I think we'll prove, and I hope we'll prove with that stream in the coming days, that we can do such a better implementation by doing, you know, torrent streaming through lower-level library like libtorrent. And obviously, you know, when I was using Popcorn Time back in the days, you know, to stream legal stuff, obviously, I was amazed by how long it was taking to run and to start. You just click on the damn thing and it takes like 2 minutes to run. I mean, it's super long. There was something going on in the background, and I wouldn't be surprised that it was due to all the dependency on all the crap that is running on top of other things, on all the things that they're doing twice because they don't know that the other library is doing it in the first hand. So it's just cumbersome, and it just ends up with loads of dependency, and just at the end, efficiency and performance suffer. And if performance suffer, you're not just doing things slower, you're also doing things differently. Because if it takes 10 minutes to do something, I'm not going to do it anymore. As opposed that if it takes -1 second, it creates new behavior and new possibilities. And so if you're loading a video, a torrent, in 3 seconds, I mean, if you just want to watch a movie, it's okay. But if you want to watch 10 seconds of that movie and then another one, if you go above 10 secs, I mean, it's going to take too long and you're not going to do that behavior. In Motionbox, it's crucial that when you load a video, it loads as fast as possible. And when I go to another one, it loads it as fast as possible. And if I go back to the first one, it just reloads the cache and doesn't reload everything from the ground up. Also, it's crucial that the Motionbox tells you that every time what you're downloading and what you're uploading, so that you can decide whether you want to continue doing that or not. It's crucial to give you control on these. And when you have all these abstraction, one other issue, I see a ton of issue just thinking about it. One other issue is that when you're encapsulating so much and abstracting so much, you don't control what happens under the hood. You don't know what this freaking stuff is doing. And even worse, I mean, you don't know what they might be doing in the future. Maybe you're depending on something very important, very crucial for your project, and the guy is going to mess it up. And then all your software is messed up. Here, it would never happen. If, for instance, Qt messes up something in the next releases, I just can just fork the file and just create another module in C++ and just re-import what was working for me previously and just compile it and it works. And I know that everything that I'm relying on should be good enough. And since I have so very few dependencies, namely Qt and libvlc, I know these guys are trustworthy. But when you're on the NPM package system, I mean, what do you know about these guys? Maybe they're not going to maintain it. Maybe they're going to do something evil. You never know. So I don't think it's a very reliable development process, and I don't see it going way beyond prototyping. I mean, sure, it's going to be useful for the web, but the web has become not that useful in the present year. So I'm a little bit worried about the direction these technologies are taking. And especially since I'm looking for a job at the moment to pay the bills, mostly because, like I mentioned, I'm not gaining a cent working on MotionBox. Well, at least a few bucks on Patreon right now, but really few. Two people are giving for now. But another thing that strikes me is that all these companies, I mean, they're moving away and they're adopting those technology before changing them, I mean, like 2 weeks later. So really, there's something wrong here, and you happen to work in all those, in all these lower level technology like I did, and now they want people that can do Node and JavaScript, and I surely can do that because I've done lots of JavaScript and QML is based on the ECMA standard. But, you know, I'm a little bit worried about all these people adopting these technologies and then moving away from these just because they want the latest abstraction, without thinking about the longer term. So performance and abstraction, yeah, on the other hand, it's very readable. Yeah, I mean, I'm not all against Node. Indeed, at the firstly, I thought that I would use it to do torrent streaming, and maybe I'll end up doing it through a plugin or something like that because it streams torrent pretty conveniently. But at the same time, looking closer, I don't really like the technology, and I don't really like the philosophy behind it. I'm not too fan about abstraction. What I really love is understanding what my code is doing. Not understanding the binary code, but understanding what happens there and being as close as possible from the technology, from the hardware, while being readable and while doing readable code. That's what I'm all about here. So now that we've, instead of talking for a long time because it might get boring, let's just populate the playlist. I'm going to do it now and we can wrap this up afterward. So also I need to practice my English a little bit because it's a bit rusty. I haven't used it for quite a long time and I'm used to speaking French, but if I was doing it in French, probably nobody would understand anything I say. But let's populate this. So if I look at this, as you can see, here there's a function called load tracks. And if I'm not mistaken, what should be happening is, oh, so if you're French, I guess we could do that stream in French, because since there's only like one viewer or so, it would be more convenient. I don't know, I thought about that. I thought about doing 1 week in French, 1 week in English. I'm not sure about it. I don't know if I'm going to keep on with the two streams a week process, but we'll see. So here, by the way, maybe you're someone I know, Chicken Skill, and you're making fun of me. Maybe you're like my brother or something like that. Okay, so So if I look inside the reply here, as you can see, there's a bunch of tracks. So what happens there is that we can declare a track, and we're going to do that now. A track item. There it is. Okay, you don't know me. Okay. and then I can pretty much just, I guess, set the source here, which is what I'm going to do. So the source would be path, but later it's going to be more complex. But right now let's keep it this way, and the title is going to be path too. And then we're going to append it like so. Also, okay. So source should be like this, and it should be loaded by default, which is the default anyway. Okay, I guess I can do that. And so now we don't need debug anymore. Who needs debug? Okay. There we go. So now we got our first AVI file that's inside of a torrent. So, okay. That's really cool. I'm really happy about that. It means we can start try to play it very soon. So not once again, but for the first time, let me tell you that everything I say during this stream sometimes might not be well thought out. So if I say something that seems unwise or anything like that, don't forget that I'm coding and listening to music at the same time. So maybe sometimes I'll say wrong stuff. So don't hesitate to point them out. And it's just like a discussion, as if we were in the same room coding stuff. And so it's not my official statement on anything, but just what I think about stuff. Like I said, I tried to be as honest as possible with that stream. I mean, besides using French as my primary language, that's the only thing, that's the only filter I do, because I want my video to be universal. At least to use the language that's mostly used nowadays, but I'll do some stuff in French in the coming days, especially a few things I want to discuss. And for instance, the node situation that you brought up, even though that technology is interesting, I see number of traps and cave ads that would be wise to point out. So maybe at one point I'll do a presentation explaining why I think abstraction is not a very good way to go. And even though you're taking a longer time to do something, maybe sometimes it's worth doing it. I see why companies are moving away from the traditional, you know, closer to hardware things of way of doing things to abstraction stuff, because they want to deliver faster. And they're all about those, these bullet points and making sure that their clients are happy. But I think as a whole for the society itself, it's not always a good way to go. Not to mention that most of these companies are going to close their code anyway. So that's also not very good. But you see nowadays a bunch of open source, as they call themselves, free software company, that are on the GitHub model and pretty much giving access to all their code while trying to profit on it. So there's a bunch of scene of people sharing code online, Node.js code, while building a company around it, which is always a bit weird, because it's weird to share something, the greatest thing that you do, you're sharing it, and then you're trying to figure a way to make money. It's always awkward, because the greatest value in what you're doing is the code. It's not anything else. So that's the situation we're at. We're in the situation there where we share the code, the greatest things that we do, we share, and then we find ways, sometimes very perverse way, to make money. And I don't want to get involved in any of that. That's the reason why the MotionBox project is non-lucrative, non-profit, and will stay this way. And if I receive any money, it will be through donation, not through advertisement, because advertisement is wrong ethically. I'm not sure they share all. Well, you're exactly right. In some cases, in most cases indeed, they're sharing the core to appeal the open source community. And then they're just having some modules, proprietary modules that they sell. Now, it's not a wrong model, as long as the core and as long as the technology itself is open. And then there's like the specific needs for the business that are private. I have nothing against that, and I have nothing about going fully proprietary if that's what they want to do. The thing that I think is wrong is that if your key value is in the code you're making, and then you're open sourcing it, then you have an issue with the enterprise, with the company traditional model, because you cannot sustain the idea of making profit if you're sharing the most valuable thing that you're doing. So there's an issue, a society issue there that we need to fix. And we could find a way, for instance, to compensate people that are sharing a lot. For instance, if I can demonstrate that you're sharing valuable stuff, and we might find some indicators to do so. I don't know, we could think about that. We could say, okay, this guy is sharing a lot. It's good for society. He needs to be compensated because he's creating value. You know, he's creating value, sharing value that is not profit. But I digress. Let's complete the stream. And next time, hopefully, we can start streaming stuff. That'll be the weekend, so I can prepare that stream a little bit better. The stream of today is a bit raw. Sorry about that, but had a busy week, like I said. Go away. Oh, it's okay, so I do that. So like you see, what happens is that it's really cool because, look, I'm just drag and dropping a torrent and boom, I'm on it. And as you can see, it's the Big Bug Bunny with a cool resolution there. Yeah, okay. And here I can drag and drop another one, for instance, and boom. And it's pretty fast to load it. I mean, I'm just opening the torrent and extracting the file, and then very soon, hopefully, we can first of all display an image here, a cool picture, like, I don't know, yeah, like a Big Bug Bunny here, Big Bug Bunny picture, and maybe really soon we can play it through LibTorrent. I'm not sure if I need SSL in LibTorrent, actually, to do that. Also, is it fast enough? Yeah, it's pretty much instant to load it. This one is a little bit longer, but as you can see, it's pretty much instant. It's less than a sec. And as long as it's less than a second to load and parse a torrent, we're good. We're good, because then we can just play it right away. And I don't need pre-cache a lot, because I'm not streaming through... I'm not going to stream through a network pipe, like PeerFlix is doing on the Node.js site, for instance, with VLC. Since I have a VLC inside MotionBox, I can just call it directly. And that's one of the reasons why it's going to be more efficient. It's because I have VLC under the hood. So guess what? I'm just going to call it directly. And I don't need to do any network piping or anything like that. I just can say VLC, you know what? There's a file there and there's content in it. Try to play it. And when I seek it, I can say to VLC, you know what? Wait for the torrent to be downloaded before seeking it. And once it's done, okay, now you can seek. So yeah, it's going to be very straightforward, hopefully. I mean, nothing is ever straightforward, but I hope it's going to be cool. So now we're going to clean that up, and I'll be wrapping this session for this time. So normally, if I remove this function, I don't need this function anymore. So we're going to remove them. I just committed them because since we spent time coding them, maybe that might be useful in the future if we need to extract more information on the torrent. But right now, that's pretty much what we get. The name is here. We could probably specify it there. If pass is empty, happen, yeah. Keep it this way, even though it's a little bit... Here, we're extracting the name. Cool. Extracting path, okay. Yeah. That's a decent extractor. Are we using these? Yeah. What about these? Nope. What about these? Yep. What about these? Nope. Okay. Just going to keep those two because we're not using the others. I mean, yeah. So Now that we have the file, the very next thing that we're going to do in the coming stream is that I'll just conclude there, and then I'll answer the question, and then I'll probably close the stream for today, because it's been like 2 hours or so. I was really tired this morning, and I hesitated of actually showing up, and I'm really happy I did it, because it's a good way for me to actually wake up early these days. But, you know, what we're going to do next time is we are going to stream these files through LibTorrent. And to achieve that, we're just going to say to LibTorrent, okay, you know what? I have this torrent that I just downloaded, so we need to find a way of actually caching it locally. Could you please open that given file inside of that given torrent and not everything else, so that LibTorrent can go as fast as possible to the file. And then we're going to do a bunch of neat tricks that I'm going to describe the next time to just extract the first and last pieces and then reading the torrent bits after bits and not randomly, so that we can stream it, which is pretty much what the streamer are doing on PeerFlix and other torrent streaming at the moment. I haven't found an implementation. Actually, I found one implementation that is using C++ to do that, but very few people are doing it. So hopefully this is going to be useful for other guys who wants to implement torrent streaming in their application. I hope so, though. So next up, when we click on that, there should be something happening. Nowadays, right now, nothing happens, but next time, hopefully, it will work. Let's try this again one last time by clearing the cache, just quitting that. Let me try it with a local file here. Yeah, as you can see, works with a local file. Let's try it with this. Yeah, Frostwire. Okay. Well, thank you very much for being here. Let me check the chat one last time before we wrap this up. Don't hesitate, by the way, to tell your friends about the cool stuff we're doing here, so we can be like, so there can be like three of us chatting, discussing what we're doing. So I'm French. Okay, I'm French too. I like your practice, your English. Thanks. Yeah, I need to. I need to focus on what I'm saying too. I do know you. I'm not sure they share all. They don't share the secret sauce, but some tools are opened. Yes, they do. Actually, they are sharing. It depends what company you're talking about. But yeah, instead of two, yeah. Actually, my next goal is that we're being consistently three person on that stream. That would be great. So, you know, I'll just tell my family, I guess, so they can pass by. So, yeah, like I said, there's a little bit of a situation right now because the very best programmer currently are not being compensated for what they're doing. Society is not recognizing the best values that are being created, except the greatest one. For instance, I'm sure Linus Torvald is fine. I'm sure Richard Stallman is okay. But I mean, the greatest values we're using in our society to pretty much power the internet is not being compensated. And that's something really wrong, especially since programmer, they need to go inside companies to be paid. And so they cannot focus on what they do best. So we have an issue. Technology is progressing so fast that right now the society, instead of pushing it forward, is trying to legalize around it and trying to make it fit inside the ancient model of capitalism. So I really think we need to come up with something new. And maybe in the next streams I'm doing, I'll be doing some presentation, because I have a lot of things actually that I've thought about these questions, including my definition of capitalism and what I call distributism, which might be a way to actually compensate people for their sharing. We'll talk about that maybe later. But for now, thank you very much for being here and for supporting me, and take really good care of you guys. So the very next stream should be next week. But you can also look at the replay if you want to review what we did today. And yeah, thank you very much and take care.